From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Review podcast. I am Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Robert Kushner to discuss his recent review published in JAMA on medications for obesity management. Dr. Kushner is professor of the Departments of Medicine and Medical Education at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine, where he is also director of the Center for Lifestyle Medicine. Welcome, Dr. Kushner.
Mary, it's a pleasure to be here with you.
Great. So let's focus our discussion today on the newer weight loss drugs. And in your review, you refer to these drugs as nutrient-stimulated hormone-based medications. So perhaps we could start by having you tell us a little bit about these new medications, what they are, and how they work.
Sure. These are a group of medications that mimic the enteropancreatic hormones, such as GLP-1, GIP, glucagon, amylin. We all know that from gastroenterology. But what we do regarding obesity, by mimicking their action on appetite suppression, they have many other actions, reducing gastric emptying, may increase insulin secretion. That's why they were founded initially for treatment of diabetes. But by harnessing their appetite suppressing effect, we now have highly effective medications. It really represents an inflection point in our treatment of obesity because they're highly effective. Most of them are given once a week by self-injection, and they have multiple targets in addition to the brain, which is responsible for the reduction in appetite.
Who is a candidate for these medications?
Well, they're approved by the FDA, which all the earlier medications are similarly approved, generally for an individual with obesity, and it's still defined by body mass index or BMI, that would be 30 or greater, or a body mass index of 27 or greater with a medical complication like hypertension or dyslipidemia. So that's what gets you in the office to be considered for the medication. The other considerations are what their current diet is, what their complications or comorbidities are regarding their obesity, their level of self-care and engagement in care while seeing you. And it's through that shared decision-making that we make a decision, is this a good medication for the patient?
And your review talks about three primary nutrient-stimulated hormone-based medications. They are liraglutide, semaglutide, and tirzepatide. How do you select between those three?
Currently, Mary, because of the difficulty and shortage and access and affordability is what you can get your hands on regarding the patient and the clinician. But if we put access and affordability and shortages aside, they are particularly semaglutide and tirzepatide are highly effective, and individuals will generally be benefited by either of these two later medications. For example, with semaglutide, individuals lose on an average of 11.5% more than placebo, or comes out to about a 15% weight loss. Tirzepatide is even more effective. It's about a 12.5% increased weight loss versus placebo, or an average weight loss of 20%. So both of them are highly effective and have multiple benefits beyond weight loss alone.
And what adverse effects do you typically see with these medications? And can you also speak to how to manage those?
Mm-hmm. Side effects are primarily gastrointestinal, such as nausea, diarrhea, constipation, could be vomiting or even abdominal pain. They are temporary and are generally considered mild or perhaps moderate. We mitigate these side effects by doing a slow dose escalation in order to ramp up to the therapeutic dose. And it's given once a week, and we increase the medication every 4 weeks. That's what the package insert recommends, and that's what was done in the phase 3 trials. But when we're seeing a patient, we do not need to escalate at the same timeline. We can slow the escalation if they're having side effects. And equally important is to counsel the patient on a healthy diet. We have learned through the phase 3 trials that by choosing smaller meals, by reducing the amount of fat in meals and greasy foods, and keeping individuals well hydrated and planning your meal pattern, we can significantly reduce these side effects and increase the likelihood we'll be able to titrate them up to a therapeutic dose.
Can you just briefly comment on what you meant by planning your meal pattern?
Yeah, some individuals on these medications have such a profound effect on appetite that they don't want to eat. And some patients will go all day without being triggered to eat. So it's very important to plan your meal structure, and that is eating three meals a day that may or may not include snacks, making sure your portion sizes are smaller, ample amounts of fruits and vegetables and whole grain foods, and equally important is do not go out to a restaurant or eat foods that you may not have total control of, particularly over the first 1 to 2 days after the injection. So for example, if you spend your weekends going out to restaurants, I would not recommend you take your injection on a Friday or a Saturday. You want control of your meal pattern.
I see. And that helps with the side effects.
It does.
Okay. And then what happens when people stop these medications?
This is probably the most important decision making between the patient and the clinician at this point. We know from the phase 3 trials with semaglutide tirzepatide that by suddenly stopping the medication, because that's how these trials were done, individuals regained 1/2 to 2/3 of the lost body weight over the subsequent half a year to a year. So that's not a good idea. Current research is investigating other therapies, such as intermittent use, where you would take the dose perhaps every other week. Other therapies are looking at reducing the dose to a minimally effective dose. Others may actually be substituting or using another medication, such as an oral medication, that may be more cost effective. We also need to be emphasizing the importance of lifestyle by watching the calories, increasing exercise, particularly resistance training and aerobic activity, because we want to preserve our muscle mass, and use the strategies that we've talked about for decades, planning your meal, monitoring your body weight, tracking your steps, setting up an environment in your home and workplace so enticing foods are not as available, and monitoring your diet.
And I want to return to this issue of long-term use. Is your practice to try to taper people down on dose or get them to intermittent use, or do you think it's okay for people who would like to continue semaglutide long-term to do so?
Yeah, it's an excellent question, Mary, and there's 2 points to come to mind. One is, we currently consider obesity a chronic progressive disease, just like we would consider diabetes or hypertension. So if we use those diseases as a comparator, we think long-term treatment, right, for hypertension or diabetes. We can try and taper the dose, but we don't need to, particularly if the patient is well controlled on medications. So we want to think the same way about obesity. If someone is tolerating medication, maintaining a lower body weight and improving their health, we may continue the medication long term. However, efforts are on the way to really answer that question. Do patients really need to be on the same dose long term, or could they be changed to another medication instead, such as an oral medication or one that's more cost effective?
For now, are there any safety issues long term that one should think about that don't come up when you first are starting the medicines?
It's important to remember that semaglutide was released under a different trade name, Ozempic, although it was at a lower dose in 2017 and has been used worldwide since that time. So we have a lot of patient years exposure to this drug. And as of now, no unanticipated safety signals or side effects have emerged. Certainly, we have post-surveillance observations going on regarding the medication, but nothing has emerged that is giving us pause that the medication is unsafe to be used long-term.
How effective is the oral semaglutide?
There is an oral form currently for diabetes that goes up to 14 milligrams a day, which is not highly effective for weight loss. However, that medication has been tested in a phase 3 trial up to 50 milligrams per day. And interestingly, the average weight loss was the same as the semaglutide 2.4 milligrams injected once a week, although that oral form is not currently available for obesity care.
I see. And your review discusses some other weight loss drugs that are less commonly used. You refer to some intragastrointestinal weight loss medications. Could you speak about that?
There's two other categories of medications that we call them earlier medications to separate them from these more effective medications. And the one you're referring to are medications that work in the gastrointestinal tract. There's only one medication on the market approved under that category, and it's well known to everyone. It's orlistat. It was approved actually in 1999. It does not affect appetite. It works by reducing about 30% of the dietary fat from being absorbed in your body. And it's also less effective, about 3% greater weight loss than placebo. Side effects of those medications are all gastrointestinal, things like oily fecal spotting, fecal urgency, and so on. There's also a device in that category, a cellulose citric acid hydrogel. It's a device. It's not a drug that swells in your stomach and is meant to make you feel full and reduce your hunger. However, that is has been pulled off the market, although not removed from the market, and that may reemerge as an option.
How about the drugs that act primarily on the central nervous system?
So that's the second category. So they, as you just said, they work directly in the brain, primarily in the hypothalamus, which is the appetite sensing area in the brain. These are probably also familiar medications. Phentermine, approved in 1959. It's the most commonly used medication in the country because it's generic and it's cheap. The second one is phentermine topiramate. That's a combination with two commonly known medications. And the third one is naltrexone bupropion, another combination medication. These are less effective than the nutrient-stimulating hormone medications, but nonetheless, many patients get benefit from them, and they're more cost-effective. Side effects from these medications typically range from dry mouth to constipation. Some of them may have producing an abnormal taste or potentially headache or dizziness.
Is there a role for combining some of these medications?
Mary, I think there is a role, but it has not been tested. I think that's important to point out. None of these medications have been approved by the FDA to be taken in combination with another anti-obesity medication. Nonetheless, if we use our common sense that we use in medicine all the time, we do use combination medications to treat a particular disorder when it needs more effective therapy. If you do combine two anti-obesity medications, I think you want to use those that have different mechanisms of action, such as a nutrient-stimulated hormone-based injection that we just talked about momentarily ago, along with a centrally acting medication.
Can you speak to why tirzepatide is more effective than semaglutide, and also what's coming down the road?
Tirzepatide is a dual agonist, so it combines the GLP-1 along with GIP, which is another incretin hormone. We don't know exactly the mechanism of why tirzepatide is more effective, but we think that the addition of the GIP, the second hormone, augments or enhances the effect of GLP-1 on the appetite centers in the brain. And indeed, it has about an average weight loss of about 5% more after the course of a year.
And what can we expect coming with regard to weight loss drugs in the future?
It is an exciting time in obesity care. There's more emerging dual agonists and even triagonists. So we're going to see combinations of GLP-1 with glucagon, as well as triagonists, where we have GLP-1, GIP, and glucagon combined. And those are currently under phase 2 trials. Also exciting is that oral small molecules are being developed. So the medications we're currently talking about are, because they're peptides, have to be taken as self-injectable medications, and because of its longer half-life, once a week. But small molecules are being developed now that also mimic the effect of GLP-1, but can be taken orally. So that's on the horizon as well.
It seems like the lay press is always coming out with articles about how the nutrient-stimulated hormone-based medications improve other aspects of health. Can you just tell us what we know about their effects on other diseases besides obesity?
Well, you touched upon, I think, one of the most exciting things in obesity is the goal in obesity has now shifted from how much weight can someone lose. to how can we help an individual living with obesity to be as healthy as they can be. And we're able to achieve that now by using these medications that have, we call, weight-independent benefits. So some of the benefits are achieved by the significant weight loss, 15 to 20% or more, but also weight-independent effects. And the best examples I can give here is the recently released SELECT trial, which was a secondary prevention cardiovascular outcome trial using semaglutide 2.4 milligrams that for the very first time showed a 20% reduction in major adverse cardiac events in individuals with obesity or overweight without diabetes. So because of that, the FDA has changed the indication for semaglutide 2.4 milligrams to anyone who's overweight or has obesity with pre-existing cardiovascular disease and removed the body mass index or BMI thresholds. For the very first time that was done. Other more recent studies have shown an improvement in sleep apnea, an improvement in MASH, which is fatty liver disease with steatohepatitis, and others are coming down the road with improvement in osteoarthritis. So those are the common things that individuals living with obesity present with, and we now have medications already approved or in the works that can improve these complications and comorbidities.
But you mentioned removing the BMI threshold and the FDA indication, but people still need to be obese, correct?
They do. However, depending upon race and ethnicity, BMI thresholds differ. For example, in the Asian population, body mass index is defined as a BMI over 27, not over 30. So BMI is a very crude estimate or definition of obesity, subject to multiple limitations. And I think getting rid of the BMI threshold will open the way for this medication to be used more broadly.
I see. Is there anything we did not cover that you would like to add today?
Yeah, I would, Mary. We have an extending portfolio of anti-obesity medications to choose from that really will help patients living with obesity have healthier lives. However, these medications will remain meaningless unless clinicians proactively assess, evaluate, and treat individuals with obesity who come to their office.
This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA. You can find a link to the paper in this episode's description. For more of our podcasts, please visit us at jamanetworkaudio.com. You can subscribe and listen wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.